I am an alcoholic. And I'm super duper nervous. I'm going to take my shoes off. Is that awkward? It is what it is. This is my home group, and it is an honor and a privilege to be of service anywhere in Alcoholics Anonymous, but especially for my home group. This is a really special place to me. Linda, thank you for introducing me. I'm glad Brad wasn't here as well, although I love Brad. Brad asked me last year, and I wasn't able to do it, and he asked me again, so I'm thankful to be able to be here. So I do have a sobriety date. My sobriety date is May 3rd, 2007. I recently celebrated an anniversary with all of you, which is was really exciting. I have a home group. This is my home group, obviously. And I have a sponsor. And my sponsor is amazing. I haven't always had a sponsor throughout my time in Alcoholics Anonymous, but I'll tell you more about that as I unpack my story. Hey, well, keep me sober over there. So I'm going to tell you what it was like, what happened, and what it is like today. So I was born and raised in Vast. That's right, Sam. You go. So if you're not familiar with Vast, you're not missing much. Sam obviously knows all about it. So Vast is just a teeny tiny little town outside of here. Not much going on in Vast, and but I loved it. I was born to a mama and a daddy who are still married today, and an older brother who is estranged from our family currently by his own doing, and that's okay. We still love him. So growing up, things were pretty good. It wasn't always terrible. I remember telling my story for years in Alcoholics Anonymous about how tragic and how horrible my life was. But the longer that I've stayed sober, I've realized like it wasn't really that bad. I mean, it wasn't excellent and outstanding and five star, but it wasn't horrible. My daddy was a good old country boy. My dad is from Scotland County, from Laurinburg. Whew, ain't nothing happening in Laurinburg. But my daddy, my daddy loved to fish, and he's just a good old country boy. And I actually have an article still from my dad about 25 years ago in the Scotland County newspaper, and he's holding up a string of catfish. And it was an article on fishing holes and fishermen in Scotland County, and there was my daddy. So that's just what he did. And my mom's from Philadelphia. It's complete opposite of my dad. My mom is wild. And my mom, she was raised in a big old Irish Catholic family and has six siblings, and raised completely different than my dad. Never wanted to touch a fishing pole or a fish or anything else outdoors ever. And so it was an interesting life growing up. I remember growing up as a kid, we fished a whole lot. My dad entered me in fishing tournaments from a very early age. We went camping a lot as a kid, and it was okay. It really was. The one thing that I remember, though, at the center of every single thing we ever did was alcohol. Alcohol was always involved. And my parents were more or less always entirely intoxicated, and that was my story later on in life. When I was about between five and seven years old, I'm not really sure how old I was, I remember that innocent little girl without a care in the world and just kind of like this free little girl. I suddenly recall having that restless, irritable, and discontent that we talk about in Alcoholics Anonymous. Suddenly, I was like consumed with this self-centered fear. I was worried about what you thought about me. I was embarrassed about the place that I live. I grew, was raised in a high-class trailer park in a double-wide trailer. But I was really embarrassed about that suddenly. You know what I mean? Like it didn't matter before that. But at a certain age, like I became really embarrassed by that, and I was embarrassed by my family and the way that they did life, and I just became consumed like with this I don't know, it's just like this self-centered fear. I also had gigantic front teeth, which does not make life easy. I really did. I had like, I swear to you, and I had a big old like overbite because I sucked my finger. I wasn't a thumb sucker, I was a finger sucker, which is really weird. I don't know. So I had this huge overbite and I had a big old gap. I managed to have huge front teeth. And so I was just like an awkward kid. I really was. And at Bass Lakeview Elementary at that time, the middle schoolers were with the kindergartners. And you know, like we were all together. This is before New Century was built. And so, you know, I wasn't necessarily picked on by the kindergartners, but I got picked on a lot. And I rode the bus. And so, like, I'd get dropped off with about seven other kids at the trailer park, and like people were throwing stuff at us. I mean, I hated school. School just sucked. I mean, I really hated going to school. My brother and I had a typical relationship growing up. And I didn't do very well in school. I wasn't very academically gifted. I had the gift of gab. I know it's hard to believe. but I was a talker. On almost all my report cards said, you know, need satisfactory or satisfactory. And then there was always, you know, a little like asterisk and a note at the bottom of my report cards that said things like, talks too much, all the time. And so that's kind of like, that's kind of how it was growing up for me. That restless, irritable, and discontent just got progressively worse for me. By the time I was, you know, 12 years old, I mean, I jokingly but realistically say that I was in desperate need of taking my very first drink of alcohol. I had tasted alcohol before this. Like I told you, my parents loved to drink every single weekend. There were bonfires, gunshots, loud music in our backyard, and if it wasn't in our backyard, it was somewhere else. But it was always a part of, like, what my family did and where we went. Alcohol dictated where we went on the weekends. And so I had access to alcohol. And I remember at one point in my life swearing that I would never be like my mom and dad. Like, I would never be like that. I saw my mom falling down. I saw my mom slurring her words. I saw my mom in blackouts. I saw my parents fight and the screaming and all the crazy. And I hated that. So much. And I remember swearing I would never be like that. And then came the day when I really, really needed relief. And I knew that alcohol would give me relief. I don't know how I knew that, but intuitively, I think we just know that. And so, you know, at 12 or 13 years old, I planned my very first drink. I had tasted alcohol before that, but I had not felt the effects of alcohol. And so two of my friends at that, well, let me back up a little bit. So at 12 years old, what happened is, there was a tragic time in my life. My best friend was killed in a hunting accident, point blank. His cousin and him were putting up the guns after they had been hunting one day, and he was shot in the chest and killed right in their den. And I talked to him for about 2.5 hours on the phone the night before. And I'm going to tell you what, for a kid that's already got a little restless, irritable, and discontent and some gigantic front teeth and had the upbringing that I had, that really put a chink in things for me. That really changed things. I remember instantly, like, every single thing shut down in me. I disconnected completely. I remember they had counselors at school to talk to the kids. I don't even know if I went, but I just completely shut down. And at that point, the friends that I associated with, they were good old country friends that I met in Bass. And very quickly, my friend group shifted almost immediately to an entirely different crowd. And so I had met two new BFFs, and BFFs who were like me, restless, irritable, and discontented, and hated life, and were just full of this angst. I just remember feeling like my skin didn't quite fit, and I wanted to tear it off of me all the time, and I just could never get settled on the inside. Like, I just had that awful, awful feeling. And so I planned my very first, like, intentional drunk. And so I went out with two of my friends. My friend had an older sister. She lied to her parents. I lied to my parents, and we ended up at someone else's house. I stole a pack of Marlboro Reds because I knew if I was going to drink professionally and well, I had to smoke because that's all I had ever seen my entire life. And so that's exactly what I did. And I ended up at this friend's sister's house. She left us there. She provided the alcohol. And I'll tell you, like, I have no idea what I drank that night, and it did not matter for me. But what happened is once I started drinking, and once I got past a certain point, you know, like, once I felt the effects of alcohol, like, suddenly my teeth shrunk, I swear to God. Suddenly, like, it was weird, you know what I mean? Like, suddenly my skin fit all of a sudden. All that pain that I had inside of me that I never knew how to process or deal with, or I never knew how to communicate unless I was, like, enraged and hurting someone, or unless I was, like, elated and on top of the world. I didn't know how to communicate with people, and all that stuff inside of me suddenly quieted and just went away for a brief moment in time. And I drank myself into a blackout that night. I absolutely loved the effect that alcohol gave me that night. And so I ended up on a waterbed with a friend of mine, which is never a good story, and I spent the rest of the night in the bathroom throwing up. I came to the next morning with a little bit of vomit in my hair, you know, matted to the side of my face. I think I still had a few cigarettes left. and you know what? Like, and I felt like death warmed over. I mean, it's an awful, awful feeling. But I wasn't even concerned with how I felt or the sickness or like any of that. What I thought about as soon as I woke up the next day was, boy, that was amazing. And when can I experience that again? Like, I mean, I would have immediately started drinking again if I could have. I loved the effect that alcohol gave me. So anyway, at 13 years old, you know, it wasn't easy to get as loaded as I wanted to all of the time, but I did the very best that I could. So on weekends, I would sneak beer out of the drawer in my parents' refrigerator. There was always liquor up in the cabinet, so I could get alcohol when I wanted to. You know, like sneaking it out little bit by little bit. You know what I mean? Like my parents drank like I drank, so they'd know if too much was missing. So I had to be careful with my alcohol stealing. But I was introduced to all sorts of other things. You know, in Bill Wilson's story, he talks about taking high-powered sedatives along with drinking in his story. And I did a whole lot of other things as well as high-powered sedative with my drinking over the course of my drinking career. I was introduced to cough syrup, which would give the exact same effect if consumed, if you drank enough of it, that alcohol would give you, right? I mean, it's not fun to do, but I did it. And so I remember, you know, I'd go to Walgreens or whatever and get 5 or 6 bottles of Robitussin and drink as much of that as I possibly could. And then go to school and I'd throw up a couple times, but I'd be good. You know, it would knock the edge off for me. I was in the band. I loved the band. I was a kid, like, I hear people's stories and they talk about soccer or softball or baseball or basketball and, like, they got something that they, you know, work really hard toward and they're really, really good at. And I had absolutely nothing until music entered my life. And so when I was in middle school, I started playing the flute and I was sure that, you know, that was going to be a life changer for me, right? I mean, I'm very grandiose. And so I had dreams to go to Juilliard and all these things. Like, so as soon as I picked it up, I mean, and I was a terrible flute player, you know what I mean? I was no good at all, but I gave it all that I had. And, but I'll tell you what, you know, in the eighth grade, they ask you before you go to high school, like, do you want to be in the marching band or the concert band or band at all, is what my band teacher, or band at all. And I said, well, I want to be in the marching band. And he said, well, so you think about, what about color guard? You know, those girls that twirl the flag. Basically, what he was saying in a very kind and loving way is you suck at playing the flute and you would probably be much better twirling the flag. And I was like, adamant about it. I was like, absolutely not. I'm going to play the flute. This is what I want to do, you know, I'm sure of it. And, you know, in our big book, talks about how the alcoholic's will is incredibly, incredibly strong. I mean, think about Bill's story, you know what I mean? Like packing up the sidecar on the scooter and like hitting the road and taking over the world. Our will is incredibly strong, except when it comes to alcohol, and that's exactly my story. And so for the next couple of years, I practiced as often as I possibly could to be the best of the best of the best. Like I never, ever, ever, ever was going to settle for second class. I just wasn't going to do it. Or for second best, you know what I mean? And so I did that. And before I was kicked out of high school, I was first chair all district. Which is pretty much the state, just so you know. No. I was first chair in the all-county band. I was in the woodwind ensemble. I think I was like second chair in the woodwind ensemble. And I was the woodwind captain in the marching band. I was killing it, dude. And every single year I won Outstanding Woodwind. But let me back up and tell you what happened, like in all these little intervals. So like what started to happen is alcohol slowly began to creep up into my band career, my band dreams. These dreams I had of performing on Broadway in the pit for like plays and go to Juilliard and all this stuff, like alcohol began to take priority. And so what would happen when I should have been practicing is I'd be like getting loaded over here. And I'd sneak out, like, after I got home from school, like, I'd sneak out in the evenings when I should be practicing, and I would start drinking. And then I'd go to school, and by 8:15, 8:30 in the morning, I'd be in someone else's car already drinking. And I'd be half toasted by the time I got back for band class. Because I always made it. This is crazy. I used to skip all the other classes, but I'd try to make it back for band class because it was the only thing I cared about. before band competitions. I used to pack a backpack full of lots of dry goods, as well as little airplane bottles of booze, and I drink them on the way to the band competitions. I've passed out on band fields. This is no lie. In a full, you know, like, let me tell you something. In the Union Mines band, we had like these huge hats, like these huge like suits of armor. Basically, it was like we were like this, you know, marching out on the field. But we had like feathers, you know, about this tall on our hats. So it was real obvious when you fall out. You know, that is not cute. But stuff like that was happening all the time. The band would, like, my band conductor would hold up the band for minutes at a time because he knew Kelly was always coming. Didn't know how well that I would perform, but I was always coming. You know what I mean? And I'd slide in there half lit almost always toward the end of my high school career. And it was awful. And my band teacher used to take me into his band room and he would have conversations with me because he knew that I could do better. You know, like our big book talks about like that frothy emotional appeal that these people in our life, behind it is a bunch of ignorance. Like they don't understand alcoholism. But I had people say to me like, you're too pretty. Why are you doing this to yourself? You've got such an amazing career ahead of you. You know, you've got scholarships that could come your way. Why are you doing this? Gosh, can't you just quit at least for this? Or just you know, get drunk after the band competition. You know what I mean? Like, show up sober. Lord knows I wanted to do that. Lord knows I wanted that education. My parents, their dream was that one of their kids would win, get a scholarship because they were poor. They worked really, really hard, but they couldn't afford an education for us. So their dream, you know, that like their daughter would have an education paid for, at least partly. And I drank it away. I couldn't do it. There's absolutely no way. And the problem was but just when I started drinking, like I just couldn't stop, no matter what other people threw at me. So by the time I was 17 years old, things were 100% out of control. I was skipping school almost always. At this point, I only was showing up for band a couple of times a week. My parents had caught on. They were very concerned about me. They thought that I was an outright mental defective, you know, the kind our big book talks about, and in fact, I was sure I was too. I had all this trauma. My best friend got shot and killed. Surely you would be drinking like I'm drinking, you know, if you had to deal with that kind of stuff. And so what happened is I was put on some medication for my mental illness, and I used to love, like, when my doctor would prescribe. It didn't matter what it was, but if it had a martini glass with a lime through it, because I knew if I took a few and drank a few, I'd go way over the mark. And so I used to love that. I never took my medication as prescribed. But anyway, so yeah, I mean, things were really out of control at 17. I was sneaking out all the time. I was drinking in the morning and pretty much through the day at this point. And I was introduced to my first treatment center at 17 years old. My parents intervened. They actually caught me after band class one day, and my mom used to wear wigs. I saw a huge wig from half a mile away, and in the old Cutlass Sierra, it looked like a boat sitting out in the parking lot. So I knew it was my mom and daddy, and I got in the back of the car, and they said the gig's up. They had found, I used to hide, this is crazy, I used to hide beer cans up in the top of my closet, and all sorts of baggies of all types of dry goods, and my parents found that. They did a little field investigation, and they found a treatment center for youth, and that was me. And at 17 years old, I was introduced to Alcoholics Anonymous. I would love to tell you that I stayed sober, but I didn't. I came to AA for the first time on October 5th, 2005. And, you know, and I picked up a white chip on a Wednesday night at the West Side Group. I cried through the entire meeting, not because I was like convicted or had a revelation or, you know, or had some type of awakening. But I cried because I looked around and everyone looked like they were about 95 years old. And I thought, my life is over. Like, this is it. You know what I mean? Like, this is what it's come to. And so I was horrified. But I went through that treatment center, and here's the thing. It was a 6-month, it was like AA boot camp. They don't even do that anymore, around here anyway. It was tough. But I went through that treatment center, and what happened is I did work the first 5 steps. And I think that these steps are designed, like, whether you want it to work or not, like, you can't help but have an experience starting to go through these steps. And I did. I began to have an experience. I began to have a spiritual awakening. I really did. I felt some relief. I actually felt better Like I was being fed and I wasn't drinking all day. You can't, when you're drinking all day long every day, you can't help but feel better, a little bit better anyway when you're not. And so I did. I got a little bit of relief going through the steps. And then my sponsor moved away and I didn't get another sponsor. I became resentful at her. I slowly disconnected in Alcoholics Anonymous. At that point I was living in a halfway house because my mama said, you are never, ever, 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 ever allowed to live here again. I had stolen from them, lied to them. My relationship with my parents were like destroyed at this point. Anyway, and so I was living in a halfway house, and I slowly but surely I stopped doing what I was asked to do in the very beginning of coming to Alcoholics Anonymous, and all that restless, irritable, and discontent that I had like all built up inside of me, those things that I had not begun to clear away. I did not complete the steps. I worked steps 1 through 5. And kind of just did that at about 50%. All that stuff began to bubble up inside of me, and once again, I drank again. And what I can tell you, when I drank again that time, it was as if I had never, ever stopped drinking before, ever. It was far, far worse. And I had heard people say that in AA, and I was like, no way. Like, how could it? No way. Surely I could drink like a normal person. Surely I could have a few to knock the edge off. And I'm telling you, it was a vicious, vicious thing when I went back out. I got kicked out of the halfway house for a whole lot of different things all at once, actually. one of those is that I wasn't sober, and other things, I won't do a fifth step here, but it was not pretty. I was dishonorably discharged, and for sure. And so what happened was I moved in with a member of Alcoholics Anonymous for a very short time. I began drinking. I was only like drinking a little though, you know, like I was trying to control it a little bit, you know, like I wasn't full on. I wasn't drinking alcoholically. But I'm going to tell you what, I can only do that for a very short amount of time, and very, very quickly, it just was full blown, and I was drinking from sun up to sundown. I destroyed this person's home while I lived there, and meanwhile, they're going to AA, you know, and I ended up stealing their car one night, wrecked it right in the front yard, hit a tree, backed up, kept on going, and proceeded to drink for the next, the next few weeks. And what happened is I ended up homeless. That person, you know, did the right, kicked me out. But here's what I can tell you. Like, I ended up in Southern Pines, not far from here, actually, at the downtown Southern Pines Park. And I had absolutely nothing. At this point, I'd lost everything. But three women from Alcoholics Anonymous that I had met here came to visit me. And they said, hey, listen, like, there's hope. You don't have to continue to live this way. You know, you can come back to the halfway house. You start your journey over. And while drinking, in the middle of the day, it was sleeting a little bit outside. This was January. I said, no, I'm good. I'm good. Like, take a little rest. You know what I mean? Like, I'm good. I was so delusional, absolutely delusional, thinking that everything was okay. You know, like, it's really not that bad. And I couch hopped for a couple of months, and I hitchhiked. I ended up in Charlotte, North Carolina. And what happened is that things got progressively worse for me. I had no contact with my parents whatsoever. At this point, if I put alcohol in my body, I could not control at all. I mean, I had lost all control of my drinking. I couldn't control how much I drank. I didn't know what was going to happen. I didn't know where I would end up, if I would end up in clothes or not in clothes, or you know, in a motel room or not in a motel room. Like, I didn't know where I would end up once I started drinking. But if I wasn't drinking, the only thing that consumed all of my thoughts, every single thought that I had, was when I was going to get another drink, how I could find another drink, who I needed to hook up with to get more alcohol. If we had a speaker not long ago, and he said that if he'd go places and he knew he could only have one drink, he wouldn't even drink because it just pissed him off. And I totally identified with that. I would not if I knew that I could only get one drink, because I knew one drink wasn't going to do it for me. And my parents, like I said, I had no contact with my parents really at this point. I went to jail while I was living in Charlotte, and you know, I used to say I wasn't jail material, but like, we're all jail material, you know what I mean? Like, we'll all end up in jail quick, won't we? And so, I can see the head's nod. But yeah, so I ended up in jail while I was there, and I was privileged enough to be introduced. You know, Mecklenburg County's got a lot of homeless shelters. It's a great place to be homeless. And they have a transportation system if you're going to do it. And so I had like, I would get on the bus, I'd be drinking. I used to take like one of those convenience store, you know, insulated cups, and I'd fill it up with liquor, with crushed ice, and I would have that for as long as I needed it. And then I'd have booze in my backpack. And I'd get on the bus and I'd drink and I'd go. I just go. And I ended up in multiple homeless shelters, and I was kicked out of those homeless shelters because I couldn't stop drinking. I didn't know that you couldn't drink if you were living there. And that people don't like it if you're drinking and they'll tell on you. And so, and that's what happened multiple times, got kicked out of there. A series of unfortunate events happened, and I ended up at a police station. It was actually the police station at the train station. And, you know, prior to that, I had called my parents multiple times, seven times approximately, over the course of that, I don't even know how many months it was, and asked them to come and pick me up because I knew that I needed to be sober. I knew that I was dying. I knew that I didn't want to continue to live that way. I really didn't. And so I called my parents to pick me up, come and pick me up. And it was always at the corner of Lucky Penny and First Street or something ridiculous or some homeless shelter or some subway or something. And they'd say, okay, because I'd get at a payphone. They'd say, okay, honey, we're going to be there, because it took exactly 2 hours and 15 minutes from Sundown Drive to Charlotte, and I knew it. And so they would say, okay, we're going to be there at 2:15 p.m. to pick you up. I'd say, okay, that's great, good. You know, I meant it this time. Every time I called them, I meant it. I really did. And my parents, at about 2 o'clock, if I knew that they were, I knew my mom was serious if she said she was coming anywhere. And so at about 2 o'clock, if I knew what time it was, I would leave the place that I said that I would be at. Because the whole time, that 2 hours and 15 minutes, I'd start to get antsy and I'd start to have this overwhelming anxiety, this thought, oh my God, like they mean business and I'm really not going to be able to drink anymore. And how could I possibly survive without alcohol in my body? Because I had been to AA before. I knew that when you said one day at a time, you meant like a lot of days at a time, really. Like you meant forever and ever. And I knew it. And I knew my mom meant that. And so this fear and this overwhelming feeling would come over me. And I just thought, I can't. There's no way. There's no way I can do that. It seemed virtually impossible to stay sober for any amount of time. And so I would leave. My parents seven separate times drove to Charlotte to pick up their little girl, and they left empty-handed every single time. That's how committed they were to my sobriety, that I wasn't. The last time what happened is I went into a police station to report somebody for punching me in the face. How dare they? And when I went into the police station, God intervened in my life. And a long story short is that my parents ended up paying for a taxi from that point for me to be brought to them. And I know that's God's intervention, because a window of opportunity was like this for me. And I believe if the exact ingredients had not been present in that moment, I would not have gotten in that taxi car and ended up back with my mom and dad. I just wouldn't have. But they fed me pizza. I'm still a sucker for pizza. And so I was like, yes. And so I ended up back with my parents. I'd love to tell you that I stayed sober. I wanted to stay sober. I needed to stay sober. My life depended on staying sober, but nothing changed for me. The whole way home, I told my parents about all these wonderful things that I was going to do and how I was going to change. And, you know, I had all these, like, these empty promises and all these things that surely, this was going to be it. And I was going to go back to AA and I was going to get a sponsor and I was going to whatever, you know, I don't know, start dieting and run, whatever. We always are going to do something. And when I got back to Moore County, back to Bass, I did the same thing that I had always done. I came back to Alcoholics Anonymous, and I sat in that chair, and I drank your coffee, and I smoked cigarettes that I probably stole, and I told you lies about how really great that I was doing with my life. And if I was feeling a little wild, I might even share about how great my life was. All the while on the inside, I was deteriorating, and I was coming unglued the whole time. But I was telling you I was good. I'm good. I'm good. I'm great. I'm good. I had a sponsor, but I waved at her across the room. I never picked up the phone and called a sponsor. I never genuinely connected with another human being in Alcoholics Anonymous. I just didn't. And the only time I prayed was at a meeting, and I did it because you did it. And so what happened for 2 weeks, I was coming out of my skin. I was absolutely miserable, and I just couldn't I couldn't stay sober, and I drank again. And this time when I drank, I was only going to drink to knock the edge off. You know, that's it. I mean, I really wasn't going to get drunk this time. Like, I just didn't want to hurt my mom and dad anymore. I didn't want to disappoint you all in AA who had so much faith in me and who loved me. I was 19 years old, and I was picking up white chips, and you all said, keep coming back, keep coming back, keep coming back. And I did. And I came back drunk a lot to AA meetings, a whole lot. But you never kicked me out. Thank goodness for that. But so what I did is I went out that night and got a 40-ounce beer to knock the edge off. And before I finished that 40-ounce beer, I was in a blackout, which had never happened to me before, ever. And I came to several days later on someone else's apartment floor in someone else's clothes, a disgusting mess. And my mother was looking down at me from the open doorway. And I don't even know how she found me. I have no idea. But she was looking down at me with disgust, horror, embarrassment, you know, all the same things that I felt about myself in that moment. And our big book talks about, you know, how we pound our fists on the bar wondering how we even started again. You know what I mean? Like, how did I end up here? I was only going to drink 40 ounces to knock the edge off. Like, how did I end up here? It was disgusting. And so there I was, and my mom poured me into the back of her seat, and if she were here telling you that story, she would tell you that she wanted to leave me on the side of the road for dead. She was so done with me. She was fed up with all the excuses, all the empty promises. Like, she was done. But she took me home, and what happened from that point is that my mama took me up to detox, and I was... They said something like, I don't know, we don't even have a bed for you or something. And like, I threw a rocking chair and threatened someone's life, which was typical Kelly behavior at that point. And they threatened to call the police, but I had been to jail and I wasn't going again. So I left as quick as I could. And my daddy worked at the hospital and he was circling around. And I believe that was God intervening again. Picked me up into his truck and he brought me home. So my parents detoxed me on a mattress in their bedroom floor. And every single night, and I was sick. I was very, very sick. I was a trembling mess. I was throwing up out of both ends of me. And every single night, though, my mama brought me to AA. And this is where I actually picked up my last white chip. And it was when we used to meet underneath here, right? It was right underneath here because the steps are out here, I believe. But the steps, for those of you who weren't here back then, they were like straight down. like you had to hold on. And I was a sick mess. And there were members of Alcoholics Anonymous that helped me down those steps, brought me into that basement, and I picked up my very last white chip. And when I came to Alcoholics Anonymous that time, I was busted, disgusted, not to be trusted. I was beaten up completely. I was humbled. I had no words. I had no empty promises left to make you or my mama or anybody else in my life. I was absolutely done. But I was sober about 7 days, and here's the kicker, and I don't think we talk about it enough in Alcoholics Anonymous, that, you know, we come here and you tell us that we need to put the drink down, but what started to happen is like all that stuff started to come up inside of me, right? So like drinking was what had always quieted all that chatter going on in my head. Drinking was what had always quieted like all that stuff. Drinking is what made my skin fit. Drinking is what made me fit in with you. Like, it was my solution. And so when I came here and I wasn't drinking, like, it was okay for like 2 or 3 days. But by day three, I was like, oh my God, I was ready to tear my skin off again. Like, I just couldn't. Like, I had such a hard time even sitting in the same room with all of you. And to listen to your laughter annoyed me. You know, like, I was just ready to hurt people. So when I was sober about a week. And it was miserable. Sobriety sucked for me. I'm here to report. But I was sober about a week. And what happened is I had made a conscious decision that I was going to drink again. And that I would never, ever, ever try to get sober again. Because I had tried many times, right? So I thought, this was going to be it. This was my last hurrah, and I was going to go all out. So what I did is I picked up the phone, because my parents at this point, they had stopped drinking. My parents had been sober for about a year. They had both gone to counseling when I was in treatment that very first time, and they had decided that they were not going to have alcohol in the house anymore. And so they had been sober for that time. So I picked up the phone to call somebody that I knew could get me alcohol that I had always gotten drunk with before. And this time they didn't answer the phone, and they always answered the phone. We didn't have cell phones. We had phones that plugged, you know, like the jack in the wall. So what happened is I went back to my room, and a moment of clarity hit me. And that moment of clarity, I heard a voice loudly say, unplug the phone. And I did that because I knew if that person called me back that I was going and that I'd be gone. And I don't think I would make it back. I don't know, but probably wouldn't make it back. And so I did that. I unplugged the phone and I went back into my room, and I had heard for every time that I'd ever come to AA, I'd heard people say, pray, pray. Like, you guys talked about prayer a lot. We prayed in meetings. I wasn't raised in church, so I thought somehow I wasn't qualified to pray. I didn't know how to pray, except for the Lord's Prayer, which you taught me in AA, and the Serenity Prayer. I don't know. I thought that there was a special way. And so what I did is I went back into my room and I prayed. And I prayed fervently. And first, I prayed that God, please just take the air from my lungs, because I didn't want to live this life anymore. I didn't want to fight for sobriety. I didn't want to fight for my life. I was just done. I had surrendered. And then probably the most humble and honest prayer I've ever prayed, even current to date, was, God, please help me. And what happened to me that night was an absolute miracle. That obsession that was so great that I was clawing at my skin and coming unhinged in my bedroom because I wanted to drink more than anything, was quieted instantly for me. And I felt the presence of something that I cannot even begin to explain to you tonight. But I call that presence the presence of God's Spirit. And I felt that warmth wrap around me, and the obsession to drink was relieved instantly. And I went to bed that night, and I hadn't slept in a long time, slept well anyway for a long time, and I slept like a baby that night. And I got up the next day, and I knew that my life would be changed forever. I just knew it. And so I went to AA, I just believe that God gave me that bit of grace so that I could stay around long enough to work the steps and unload all that garbage inside of me, to really have freedom for the rest of my life. And that's exactly what I did. I came back to Alcoholics Anonymous. I had already picked up my last white chip, and I came in and I grabbed a woman that I had seen coming around AA for the last, I think she was 9 years sober at that time maybe, and I said, please, you've got to help me. You have to help me. Whatever it takes, I'll do whatever. And so she did. She said, all right, kid, don't hurt me. I was coming at her strong because I knew my life depended on it. Although I had been relieved of that obsession, I knew that my life depended on working these steps and staying here for sure, because I had heard a lot of people's stories. And so I met with that woman every single week. And I share this every time I tell my story and every time I speak about sponsorship. I'd go to my sponsor's house. She was super busy. She housed her daughter, who was a grown adult, and her daughter's children, bless her heart. But anyway, she was very busy with grandchildren and her daughter. But she invited me to her house every week while she cooked dinner. It was dinner time, and I read from the big book, and it was wonderful. I was so excited to be there, and I was so excited that she was making just a little bit of time for me. It was and I was just so excited. I was so hungry for whatever you people had been talking about for every time I came to AA. You people acted enthusiastic and excited about something, and I knew it was in the big book. That's what I'd heard, and so I was just excited, and I dug into that book, man, and I ripped it apart. And I loved it. And I began to have an experience as I went through those steps. I began to become freer and freer and freer as I unpacked the 12 steps with her. And then what happened is I got involved in a big book study. And I continued to go through the steps in that big book study. And when it asked us to do something like pray or write, we did that at every single point. And we would unpack three sentences. Sometimes that's all we even got to. And that was okay. I loved it. And then when I was 39 days sober, it was really weird. So my sponsor was we're going to Founders Day. And I'm I have no idea what that is, but sign me up. I was just so excited, I didn't care. She said, do something. I was yes. And so we did. And it was up in Akron, Ohio. And I had never left Charlotte and Bass was it for me. I had never left North Carolina. And so I was Ohio, yes. And so we went to Ohio, and but here's what happened. This was such a weird thing. So this super cute guy got in the back seat with me and my sponsor. And of course she sat in the middle, good for her. But she was amazing. She knew what she was doing. But so we all rode up, and his sponsor was in the car. And anyway, it was just cool. It was the five of us. And so we all rode up to Akron, Ohio. And Akron, Ohio is the birthplace of Alcoholics Anonymous. And we got to be a part of this huge, huge convention. And Dude, I was blown away, and like we got connected with these members who were like a part of the Founders Day committee, and they invited us into their home to stay with them. Like, what? Where on earth does that happen? Like, I'm a punk kid. Like, I will steal everything from you. Like, you do not know me. And but they were alcoholic too, and they, of course, they know me. They're just like me. But they invited us into their home, and they made beds for us, and they fed us, and like I was like, what? I was blown away by that. And then I went into the meeting space, and it was this huge auditorium, and like thousands of alcoholics are hanging out and laughing and probably telling lies and drinking coffee. And like, I mean, it was amazing. It was absolutely incredible. And so I was thrust into Alcoholics Anonymous. And I'm gonna tell you what, like, it wasn't a vacation, because I got designated as the handshaker, the greeter. You talk about boom, boom, boom. Like, I thought my shoulder was gonna fall off. I shook so many hands that day. But it was wonderful. It was just such an exciting thing, you know, to be like right in the middle of Alcoholics Anonymous. And then I got to go to Dr. Bob's home, and it was just so cool. Like, I was just so humbled by the love and the grace that Alcoholics Anonymous gave me and filled me with. And so when we went up in Dr. Bob's house, upstairs there are these bedrooms where guests used to stay. And Wallace, this old guy over here, I didn't know like how cool Wallace really was that night, you know, that day, but I ended up running into him. And so we went upstairs into one of the bedrooms, and there laying on the bed was the third step prayer printed out. And so we got down on our knees and we took the third step together, and a revolutionary change happened within me that day, I can tell you. When I got up from that bedside, I don't know, like, it's weird. The power of God goes deep. Steve says it all the time. I can't explain to you what happened. I don't know. But I can tell you that my life has not been the same since I worked those steps with my sponsor, and I've continued this process. When I was 6 months sober, my sponsor said, "You need to be helping somebody. You're thinking too much about yourself." I was like, "Me?" And so I like taking too much time in the mirror, getting cute before meeting and stuff. And so she's like, "You need to be helping somebody." And so I did that. There was a woman that came to the Bethany house and was brand new. And I started sponsoring her. My sponsor was like secretly sponsoring her on the side, but it didn't matter. Like, I met with this girl every single week. And we went through the big book the exact same way that I did in that first big book study. I believe if you are sober and you have worked those 12 steps, I don't care if you're 30 days sober, 90 days sober, 6 months, and you are not working with another alcoholic, you are being selfish. This program talks about giving it away. And immediately my sponsor said, I had finished those 12 steps in 6 months, and she said, "Give it away. Don't sit around and sit on the experience that you've had. You've been selfish your entire life." And I was like, "Yes, you are right." And so I did that. When I was a kid, I used to, you know, when my parents would be drinking in the evening and partying and doing all that fun stuff, I used to go in my bedroom, and I would paint my nails. You know, bright red, and I had my baby dolls, and I used to line my baby dolls up, you know, in my room, and I had a dream of being a teacher, and because when I went to school, I was loved by my teachers. I was given the attention that I craved by my teachers, and my teachers took me under their wing, and they spent a lot of time with me, and so I used to pretend to be a teacher, like when I was a little girl, and but alcohol took that dream away from me, and but you know what's really awesome as a result of these steps and sponsorship and God's grace? Today I'm a teacher, and I get to like love and hold and be with my students and give them, you know, what other teachers have given me. And that's a really beautiful thing. I teach at a little private preschool, and sometimes I look around and I'm like, man, if these people knew, like if they only knew, you know what I mean? Like, you are allowing me with your kid? I'm like, but it's an absolute miracle. It really is. That handsome young man that I rode up there with me to Founders Day, we started dating. Here's what I can tell you about that is a lot. We don't have time. But I can tell you is that my sponsor said to me, she said, as long as you stick close to Alcoholics Anonymous and the God of your understanding, and you continue to help other women, you can do anything that you want to do. And in fact, our big book talks about that. We can go to whoopee parties, honey. I've been to bars in sobriety. I mean, I don't recommend it, but I went like bar hopping until 3 o'clock in the morning one night dancing and didn't get drunk. It's an absolute miracle. Amanda's in the back. We were like living it up. But you know, so like she told me, as long as you stick close to AA and your relationship with God, you do anything. And I got in a relationship with that man 4 years later on top of a mountain, at the summit of the mountain. He turned around and proposed to me, and we've been married for 8 years, I think. And it's been a good 8 years. Also, in sobriety, I began to take care of my health and started going to doctors. I hadn't been to a doctor's, dentist, anything in a long time. And so I started to take care of my health. And what I found out is I have a medical condition that makes it very difficult for women to have babies. And I was devastated by that because I'd always wanted children. I believed that God would give me a bunch of kids. And so what happened, though, is, you know, I have a precious five-year-old little boy. And that happened 2 years after I got married. So, like, God is so good. I also have had tragedies in sobriety. You know, we thought we'd have a whole bunch of kids. And so we found out we were pregnant earlier this year. We were like, man, that's super awesome. Like, you know, we were patient with it. You know, we were faithful about it. We put it in God's hands. And we were like, man, such perfect timing. Like, God has been so good to us. And we went to the doctor, and we had a perfect heartbeat, and everything was, oh, man, we celebrated, and we, like, shouted it from the rooftops, and, like, what a wonderful life. And then we went back to the doctor only to find out that we had lost our baby. And here's what I can tell you about that, is that because of Alcoholics Anonymous, sponsorship, each of you, and God's amazing grace, like, I didn't find it necessary to take a drink. And I assure you, that would have been a wonderful excuse for me years ago. But I didn't do that. Instead, I worked with another alcoholic. I prayed. I did a whole lot of crying. And I called my sponsor, and I got back up, right? Because that's what we do. I have an amazing life today because of Alcoholics Anonymous. I do walk a free woman. I walk with my head held high. I try to walk with dignity and grace, and I try to always have a handout for the next woman who comes behind me, because that, I believe, is the absolute most important thing that we can do here. Thank you so much for letting me share.